Dear loving children, welcome to the online class of class 9th Economics, Chapter 2, People as Resources. In the previous class, we learned about what is the role of education in the formation of human capital. We also learned about what is the role of health in the formation of human capital. We also learned about why people are considered as a resource. Before we move on to the next part of the class, I would like to remind you that you should write down the questions answers neatly in your notebook. You should learn them. And we must get ready for the test the very next day. The test will be available from 2 p.m. onwards. I want that you should write down the notes point wise in your notebook. You should write the exam. Exam is mandatory for all the students. If you write exams only, you will get attendance. So I want that the students also should read the textbook two or three times so that you may understand the lesson much better. Welcome to the online class of class 9th. Today we will be continuing with the economics chapter 2, People as a Resource. The previous online class we studied about how people can become a resource. We also learned about what is the role of education in human capital formation. We found out how education can play an important role in making people an asset for the nation. And in another question, we learned about the role of health in human capital formation. We studied how health plays an important role in increasing productivity. How a healthy nation is a blessing for the country. We also learned about what are the steps taken by the government of India, the government of various states, to promote education in India. And we also learned about what are economic activities. Now let us move on to the next question of this chapter. I think the seventh question of this chapter, people as a resource. Let us move on to that question. What are non-economic activities? Those activities which do not bring any monetary benefits are called non-economic activities. For example, farming for self-consumption. Suppose you are cultivating rice or wheat, maybe vegetables, only for self-consumption, for the use of your family only, not for selling in the market. Another example you can see here, cooking food at home, non-economic activity. We do not get any monetary benefits. The ladies are cooking at home. They are not paid any salary for the work which they do. Or you can see another picture, people are fishing in the river just for a consumption of fish in the family. So such kind of activities are called non-economic activities, which
do not bring any monetary, any benefits, economical benefits. You don't get any money for that. So, I hope you have understood what are non-economic activities. Now, let us move on to the next question. Why are women employed in low-paid work? A majority of women have meagre education and low skill formation. Most of the women, you know, the India's literacy rate, when men, they have a literacy rate of 76%, whereas women, they have only 54%. Some states, like maybe Bihar, maybe it is less than maybe 40%. So that is the reason why women are employed in low paid work. They have very little education. Meagre means very little education. And they don't have a proper skill. And second point, women workers are not highly skilled and educated. That is why they are, you can see in the picture here, they are cultivating paddy, rice. And some places they are used for, you can see, they are, women are used for even plowing the field. So, another point, women are paid low as compared to men in many fields. Let us take the example. When women work in the field, they are paid less money than men. When men are paid maybe 800 rupees, women may be paid 400 or 500 rupees. Let us take the case of cinema. In the cinema, you will find the male actors get sometimes in crores. And the women actress, they get less money as compared to men. Maybe in sports, maybe in cinema, maybe in industry, everywhere you find that women are paid low as compared to men in many fields. Another point, in unorganized sector, you know, private job, private places, there is no job security for women. Women do not get, do not enjoy many of these benefits, maternity leave and many other benefits they may not get. There is no job security for women. That is why women are employed in carrying various works. So you can see in the picture, the women are made to do all this kind of work. So they are carrying maybe rocks, maybe they are doing some other work. They are paid less money in various fields. That is actually an injustice. Women should be paid as equal as men. Let us come to the next question. Why educated parents spend more money on the education of their children? You know, educated parents invest more money on the education of their children because they know the benefits of education. Educated parents are found to invest more heavily on their children because they consider it as a best investment in life. Education is the best investment in life. Every parent should provide maximum education to their children, whether they are boys or girls, so that they can stand on their feet, they can become self-dependent. They don't have to depend on anyone else. They should be skilled, trained, so that they can get a job of their own, or they can start business of their own. Second reason, those parents, educated parents, have realized the importance of education for themselves. They have realized the importance of education for themselves, how education improved their standard of living, how it improved their hygiene, how it improved their status in the society. They are able to enjoy all those benefits which they are having today because of the education. their children can yield a higher return in the form of higher earnings and greater contribution to society. Educated parent children, suppose a doctor's child becomes a doctor, or an engineer child becomes an engineer. Their children can earn yield give a higher return in the form of higher earnings. Nurses, doctors, engineers. So, if they are highly educated, scientists, pilots, lawyers, if they are highly educated and a Supreme Court lawyer gets for sittings in lakhs, so their children can yield a higher return in the form of higher earnings and they can do greater contribution to society. They are also conscious of the proper nutrition and hygiene of their children. Since they are educated, they are concerned about providing proper nutritious food to their children. They keep their surroundings neat and clean. Hygiene, they are concerned about. On the other hand, illiterate parents keep their children in a disadvantaged state. On the other hand, if the parents are illiterate, they will not spend money on the education of the children, and their children will, suppose a fisherman's child will learn to become a fisherman, and he will be living in a poor surroundings, poor health facilities. On the other hand, let us take the case of APJ Abdul Kalam. Even though he was born in a fisherman's family, he was interested in education, and he became the missile man of India. Later he became the president of India. We have another person, Dr. K.G. Balakrishnan, the Supreme Court Chief Justice of India, the previous Chief Justice of India. From a law background, but with education, he was able to reach a higher level. We have the example of K.R. Narayanan, the President of India. So they were all from the law background, but poor families, but education brought about a change in their life. They could contribute greater for the society. So that is the advantage of education. That is why educated parents spend more money on the education of their children. They may borrow money from the bank, they may take a loan from the bank and spend it on their children so that they can get a higher return in the form of better salaries. Next, let us try to understand the term unemployment. What do you understand by the term unemployment? Unemployment is a situation in which people are willing to work, but they cannot find jobs at the going wages. They are ready to work, but they do not find jobs. Unemployment rate is very high in India. Many countries are facing this problem of unemployment. Under our present situation, COVID-19, we know that many people are losing their jobs. When there is an economic depression, a lot of people lose jobs. So, India, what is the problem? Many people with graduation and post-graduation degrees are not able to find jobs. The people search only for white collar jobs. So every year lakhs of graduates and postgraduates come out from the universities and colleges and they are not able to find jobs. They prefer white collar jobs. So they suffer from unemployment. Unemployment rate is very high in India. You can see a lot of people here. Even in our marketplaces, we can find a lot of people coming and standing in the morning to get jobs. So those lucky ones get, others may not get. So Unemployment is a great problem faced by our country. It's a situation in which people are willing to work, but they cannot find jobs at the going wages. Now let us come to the next question. What are the various activities undertaken in the primary, secondary and tertiary sectors? What are the various activities undertaken in the primary sector? The primary sector, we know that we have agriculture and we have forestry, development of forests, and we have animal husbandry, dairy farming, keeping animals and selling milk and milk products. And we have another one, we saw earlier picture of a fishing. And another primary sector activity is a poultry farming, you can see, poultry farming. Keeping a poultry farm and making money. And then we have, can see here in the picture, you can find quarrying. You can find a quarrying here, cutting of rocks, that is in the primary sector. And you can see here, you can find a mining activity going on, mining of a coal. So these are all some of the activities in the primary sector: agriculture, farming, forestry, animal husbandry, dairy farming, keeping animals, okay, fishing and poultry farming, mining and quarrying are some of the activities undertaken in the primary sector. Now let us move on to the secondary sector. Secondary sector means manufacturing of various goods, manufacturing, adding value to the production. We have example, we have iron and steel industry. You can see in the picture, iron and steel industry. We have a Bhilai iron and steel industry. We have Rourkela steel and steel industry. We have Bokaro steel industry, iron and steel industry. Iron and steel industry is called the basic industry because all other industries depend on iron and steel industry. So all the machines are made of iron and steel. So they are called iron and steel is called a basic industry. And we have another one, we have the sugar production. From sugar cane you produce sugar. You can find sugar cane mills, North India, even South India, many places you will find sugar cane producing factories. So you can see here, that is also in the secondary sector, adding value adding value to the production. So flour mills, sugar production, iron and steel, petrochemical industries, anything you find they are in the secondary sector, manufacturing sector. And another one we can see, car manufacturing industries, manufacturing of cars. Millions of cars are produced and sold. Let us move on to the next sector, tertiary sector. Tertiary sector means providing services. Tertiary sector means we have a trade, business, trade with other countries, trade within the country, then providing transport services. You can see the picture, transport services, aeroplane service. And we have bullet train, train service. And development of port, shipping. And another important aspect is banking service, commercial banks, nationalized banks, State Bank of India, Canara Bank, like that, so many banks, banking services, communication, all this communication network. So providing communication service, we have Idea, Jio, okay, Airtel, etc. and providing insurance services. We have insurance companies are there, LIC, Star Plus, Bajaj Insurance, etc. So we find insurance companies. And next, tertiary sector providing health services, hospitals, clinics, promoting tourism. You can see in the picture here, you can see here how houseboats of Kuttanad, how tourism can be promoted. Then education, setting up schools and colleges. All these are tertiary sector. We must understand if we want our country to become a developed country, we must concentrate more on tertiary sector and secondary sector. Those countries which have become a developed country, it is because they concentrated more on tertiary sector and secondary sector. So, Japan or America, maybe Germany, you'll find all these countries, France, because they depend more on tertiary sector and secondary sector. If a country wants to be developed, they should concentrate more on secondary and tertiary sector. Now let us try to find out how Japan became a developed country. We must understand the situation of Japan. Japan did not have any natural resources. They don't have much natural resources. They import natural resources from other countries like Asia, Africa, etc. Iron, other metals, other resources. They are importing from other countries and they are adding value to that. So, that is a speciality of Japan. Japan did not have any natural resources of their own. They import natural resources from other countries like Asia, Africa, etc. And they have invested on people, especially in the field of education and health. You can see how the Japanese people invest on education. You can see their classrooms. You can see how they have set up schools. They spend more money in the field of education and health. They are concerned about the health of the people. So they set up better hospitals, better clinics. And up to the age of 10, the Japanese people, they teach children basic manners, how to keep the surroundings neat and clean. They teach them basic manners of life. And I think from 5th standard onwards only they start teaching real subjects. So the people of Japan, they have understood the value of education. So they invest heavily in the field of education and health. Japanese people have made efficient use of other resources like land and capital. They have made efficient use of other resources like land and capital. So, the Japanese method of farming, they have introduced a scientific method of farming. They are able to produce more from a small land by using a scientific method of farming. They spend money, capital, they spend money in building, railway network, metro trains, magnetic metro trains they have. And they have flyovers. And they have a good transport system. Efficiency and technology evolved by the Japanese have made them developed. They have efficiency and technology. They use the latest technology and they are efficient. They You can see in the picture, you can find how the technology is used, how do they cultivate, how do they cultivate the field with the modern technology. And the technology they used in the manufacture of the cars, Nissan cars of Japan, or you will find how the latest technology is being used. They produce only quality goods and services. That is the basic quality of Japanese. They produce only quality goods and services. Anything made in Japan, you can close your eyes and buy. So people all over the world, they buy Japanese products because they trust its quality. So the Japanese people produce only quality goods and services. So the people of Japan, they are highly disciplined. They don't, they have a work culture. They keep the surroundings neat and clean. So that is the reason, you know, in spite of earthquakes, other disasters, the Japanese have become a developed country. So they have made efficient use of resources like land and capital. They use technology. They produce quality goods. That is the reason how Japan became a developed country.
So dear children, with that question, we have come to the end of today's online class. Today we learned about what are the non-economic activities. We learned about how Japan became a developed country. We learned about tertiary activities, secondary activities and primary activities. So I want all of you to write down this question answers seriously in your notebook. And learn those question answers. And the very next day at 2 o'clock there will be an exam. All the students must attend this exam. This exam will be, you can do it from 2 o'clock to 8 p.m. After 8 p.m. the responses will not be accepted, and your attendance will be marked based on the test that you have taken. If you do not write exam, you will not get attendance. So test is compulsory for all the students. So please study seriously and write the exam and try to score above 80%.